We took a turn recently. We are still actually talking about the prodigal son story, but we're actually entering greater ground or greater explanations of that story. And some of the things that I'll be touching on tonight are important points that, as long as we're dealing with the prodigal son story, or what I just call simply the firstborn, as long as we're dealing with that, these points that we're going to be touching on tonight and probably next week, it might be a little bit tedious, but the points themselves are going to be in the stories that we go to. And we're going to, Lord willing, we'll end up going to a lot of stories with this same stuff in it. A lot. An amazing lot. So, so if you would, turn with me to Exodus chapter 4. And right here at the beginning, we're just going to go over a few reminder stuff. Particularly, Exodus 4:21 will be a theme throughout now. Any story, any place that we go to, this will be a theme through that, except it won't have to do with Egypt. Exodus 4:21, and the Lord said unto Moses, when thou goest to return into Egypt, see that thou do all those wonders before Pharaoh, which I have put in thine hand. But I will harden his heart, that he shall not let the people go. Thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And I say unto thee, let my son go. This is God the Father speaking, that he may serve me. And if thou refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay thy son, even thy firstborn. Okay, so just in general, there's a lot of external stuff in relationship to that that sometimes we have to negotiate, navigate, before we can get along further down the road. One of the things is that the Lord says, well, I will harden Pharaoh's heart. And that's always a big one for everybody. They don't get it. Okay, God's telling him to let him go, but he's hardened his heart, so he won't. So this is a stumbling block for me, because I don't get it. Okay, maybe I can give a little explanation, which, by the way, I think I shared a whole newsletter on this specific thing, and it was good. But the short version is, the short version of this is that the scripture goes on to say, which we don't have here, but it goes on to say that I might show Pharaoh and Egypt and literally the world my power. My power. So then when we read that, then we go, okay, well, God's just on an ego trip because he wants to show his power. And so if he can't find somebody to do it, he'll just harden their heart. He'll just, you know, it's just all kind of stuff that really shows we don't really know our Father who wants his son. And the short version is that he does show his power, and his power was that which delivered Israel, or his firstborn, from Egypt. And his power was not any of the plagues, not the locusts, not the, you know, all the different things, blood, water turned to blood, or, you know, the ants because of the rain, or, oh, wait a minute. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, that wasn't one of them. yeah, the chiggers, yes. I attest to that as a plague, personally. So it's called 10 plagues, and none of the 9 delivered him or them. It was the power of the slain lamb, the death of the lamb. That was the power that delivered him. All of those what we would call power, all of those power plagues didn't do it, but the lamb did it. And so because we are weak in constitution and God said, I'm doing this to show my power, the last couple of them, or at least one of them, Pharaoh's about ready to let him go over one of the plagues instead of the lamb, and he hardened his heart. So he's going, look, I'm trying to show my power here, buddy, you know. And I don't want everybody to think my power is plagues, yeah, frogs, you know, and your warts. That's power. I want the whole world to know that, you know. But instead, his power is the Lamb of God, which delivered us, which defeated Satan, which defeated the old nature, which defeated the law, which defeated on and on and on and on, the death of the Lamb. And that was the purpose for hardening his heart. So let's move on to just this thought. He said, what we just read in the scriptures there in Exodus 4, he said, let my son go. Let my firstborn go. And I said last time that this thing of the firstborn is all the way through the Bible, and it's just incredible, and it's over in places and just things that you would not imagine. God is saying, let my firstborn go. All right. Now, how many of you feel like you have a pretty good grasp of the meaning of firstborn throughout the scriptures? Raise your hand. Feel free to do. Caitlin, you do, okay? No, this is going on tape, so I'm there. So all generations to come will come to Caitlin for that. Well, Mike wasn't here tonight, so I couldn't. Yeah, he is somewhere. Okay. So let my people go. But the next question we have to ask, let my firstborn go, let my son go. The next question we have to ask, and we did touch on it a little bit, is where are they going? Okay. All right. So the first answer is they're going to the Father. The Father is saying, let my son go. And basically saying, let him come to me. And let my firstborn go. Let him come to me. All right? But that's not the full answer. And in the scriptures, there are 3 particular words that signify, together they signify a balanced picture of where God is bringing his son when he brings him to him. When his son is with him. And this is true of his son in you. This is true of the firstborn in you. When you begin to let him go, instead of put him in bondage to you, to your mind, to your wants and desires, to your earthly viewpoints, because he was just as much in bondage in Israel as Israel was in bondage in Egypt. And the Father is calling out his son to him. Let him go. I mean, if you could hear God speaking to you and he's saying, let my son go out of you. Turn him loose. Release him from bondage. The bondage of that is you. The bondage that is you. Because we all say, well, I got Jesus in me. You know? Okay, well, there you go. So we got problems then because he's in you, all right? Okay, so those three words are, let's just take it from the scriptures. And this one is a different scripture than what we just read, but it sounds similar. It's Exodus 7:16, if you'll turn there. And it might be good to, if you're one of those that has a Bible and don't mind marking in it, then it might be good to mark these things because they are very significant and they're going to come up later. And some of them have already come up. And I know that different people relate to their Bibles in different ways. I know I was a Jesus freak come to Bible school, and one of the first things that a bunch of us did was they had swing sets for the kids, and of course we, Jesus freak hippies, ran to the swings to play on them, you know. And I jumped in one, and I took my Bible, and I threw it down, and one of the Assembly of God students said, you threw the Bible down. You desecrated the Bible. He said, I said, look, that's ink on white paper. We're after Jesus. That's supposed to tell us about Jesus. You know, it's not, the leaves in that are not sacred. They're not, there's nothing sacred about it. And, well, you're treating it wrong. No, I read it regularly. I'll open it up and show you. It's marked like crazy. You know, and when I threw it on the ground, none of those markings fell out. You know, anyway, I guess I still hold to that. But for those of you who have a sanctified Bible, please don't throw it on the ground. All right, Exodus 7:16. And thou shalt say unto him, the Lord God of the Hebrews hath sent me unto thee, saying, let my people go, that they may, and here it is, that they may serve me in the wilderness. And behold, hitherto thou wouldest not hear. So, there's three words, specific words here, and they're going to bring balance to the understanding of where God wants his son when he's with him. What he wants his son related to when he's with him. All right, so the first one is that he might serve me, but the other two are going to give definition to what kind of service. All right, so Exodus chapter 5, verse 1. Exodus 5, verse 1. And afterwards Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord God of Israel. Now, isn't it interesting that the first scripture that we read says the Lord God of the Hebrews? Okay, well, who is the first Hebrew? Not Jim Allen. I know he brews coffee, but it was Abraham. Hebrew. So, but this one says, verse 5, or verse 1 of chapter 5 says, the Lord God of Israel, let my people go that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness. Okay, so you have service or serving, but now that is getting specific. It is specific to a feast. Now, you know, again, the classes for tonight and tomorrow night are going to just be setting you up for the good stuff. But where have you heard that word feast before? Pardon? Luke 15, the prodigal son story. Okay. So what was it that initiated that? It was the born-again son coming back to the father and being about repentance. But the father not being about repentance, but about seeing his son, not a failure, not someone who has royally messed up, but rather puts the signet ring on him, puts the robe on him, puts the shoes on him, and is kissing him as if he were the son. And all of that interchange between the Father and the Son does not enlighten the Son yet. He is taken with the face of the Father, but he is not enlightened as to who he is fully yet until from that moment he is taken to the fatted calf where he is slain and where he is cut open and where the Father explains what they are, who they are. And let me just tell you this. Everything in that prodigal son story that I said like that was something like that, but the scriptures didn't say that. You understand what I'm saying? I'm saying that I said that the Father took him to the altar and showed him the sacrifice, and yet the scriptures don't say. The scriptures make it sound like he just got him a cow and killed it and they ate it. I promise you, not just that one, but every one that I've told up to this time, like, for example, the one where the Father is trying to get his son instead of just get, you know, his prodigal son repentant. He's trying to get his son, Jesus, the Son, out of him. I promise you that all of these scriptures that we're going to get into will verify that. We'll go over and over and over because it's a pattern. And the prodigal son story was like a really loose outline that all of the history of Israel, all the way through even into the New Testament, screamed the truth that it was an altar and it was a sacrifice and he ate the sacrifice. And it's at that sacrifice where you become enlightened. The Father's face at you realize that he's seeing the Son, he's not seeing you. And that's an awakening. But to go to the altar with the Father and have him take you through the meaning of the sacrifice, which he is saying, this is us, this is our family. You're my son by the Son. And remember what was the last week, I think it was, that I ranted and raved about you don't have a relationship with the Father. It is, your relationship is with the Son unto the Father. So it is by the Son, his relationship. I guarantee, again, that we are going to see that over and over and over again in scriptures. And I cannot stress enough when I say over and over and over and over and over and over and over. I could keep going. It is incredible. It's incredible. All right. So what was that last one you held up? One second? 1.5 minutes. Okay. So then I'm going to just knock out this third one. Exodus 5, just go up 2 verses, 5 verse 3. And they said, the God of the Hebrews hath met with us. Let us go, we pray thee, 3 days journey into the desert and sacrifice unto the Lord our God. So what do you have? We want to go, the Father wants his son out there to serve him. He wants to serve him in relationship to the feast. He wants to serve him in relationship to sacrifice. This is where the son is going. He is doing this in relationship with the Father, and he's doing this in relationship to what the Father wants, get ready, out of us. Is that not exciting to get anybody? That's good stuff, actually. Hallelujah. Okay, so let's take a break. We'll come back and we'll talk a little bit more about the Passover.